Hi, my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. Many of you are beginning your PhD journey or thinking about the process, and today I wanted to talk about setting realistic PhD timelines. It can be kind of tricky to know when to do things at certain times, how long it's going to take you. So I want to give you some guidance on the general norms, things that are myths that are not actually true, and a way to make this PhD journey sustainable. So let's jump on in. So let's begin with the myth of the four-year PhD. I don't think I know a single person, a real person, who has completed their PhD in 4 years. It's really challenging to do so. Sometimes you hear about it online, but I think it's very, very rare. I don't know anyone personally who's done it. Now, why would you even want to do that? I think part of what goes on is that you might have come from your undergrad, and that's about packing things in, getting things done as quickly as possible to move on to the next phase of your life. Or you might just be not wanting to spend 5, 6, 7 years on your PhD, so you want to get it done quickly, move on, etc. I get it. I hear you. I think, though, the PhD time is different, and I think you should think about it time differently during your PhD. So what is going on in your PhD is you have a certain period of time where you have access to all the resources, the faculty members, and a stipend. You should not be accepting PhDs that are self-funded, okay? I have a whole video on funding, but just as a summary of that, I think you should only accept a PhD if you get a TA stipend or research assistant stipend. I think paying it yourself is not worth it, like maybe controversial. So I think that you should, you know, take these funded positions. So that means you have a guaranteed job for the duration of your PhD for the most part. What happens when you sign up for a PhD is there's a contract, and it might say guaranteed funding for 4 years or 5 years, okay? So whatever it says, it's guaranteed. The department's gonna have to find it. Maybe the original grant that your advisor was on went away, who knows? It doesn't matter to you. You signed a contract, they need to find money for that, okay? So just be aware that that is a contractual agreement that you have a job for that period of time that gives you a particular salary. So if you think about it, rather than trying to make it through and get done as quickly as possible to get onto your next job, think about it as a time to build the strongest possible application to essentially be able to outcompete everyone else who's applying for those top jobs. It's really this kind of leisure time, honestly, to be as strong of an applicant, to learn as much as you can as possible. You will never get this time again. This is gonna be the only time in your life where your whole mission is dedicating yourself to advancing yourself as a scholar. And that's a really amazing opportunity. So I would encourage you not to shorten it just to get it over with, because you will lose that opportunity of the intellectual development that comes along with those kind of later years in your PhD, and you lose access to resources, which is another key element of it. So sure, the four-year PhD, people say they do it. I don't think you should do it. I think it's very rare when other people do it as well. The average time to do a PhD is 5 to 6 years. So I think the true average time is like 5.5 years. And that's a pretty good amount of time. So the way that your time will be organized is your first few years will probably be a little bit more heavy on coursework. And then the final years, you'll be working on your PhD, whatever your PhD is. So those last years are the coveted years where you don't have coursework anymore and you're just spending 40 hours a week just thinking about your research idea, just working on your work. The reason that this is coveted time is everything that you do goes with you. Everything, every experiment you run, every paper you write, every manuscript you submit, sure, you're doing that with your advisor and with the university, but it goes with you. You're building these things that are on your CV that you're the author of, okay? You own that material, which is really cool. So you're having this period of time, 2, 3 years, where your only mission is to make yourself as strong of an applicant and build up all of those things as possible. There's no other job in the world where you get to spend at least 2 full years fully funded to make yourself a stronger applicant for your next job. That's amazing. That is truly, truly miraculous. So you should take advantage of that and don't necessarily cut your PhD short. So the standard or the recommended PhD timeline is 5 years. I would say it takes about 5.5 years to finish to 6 years, but what most departments will want you to do is to finish it in 5 years because ultimately they are on the hook to give you salary if you extend longer. And most departments are kind and nice, and if it does take you longer, they will try to find you funding. But it's a more of a scramble for them because they haven't set aside these funds for you in particular. But 5 years is about what they're going to expect, and they'll try to nudge you along if you're going a little bit more slowly. So what that means is that you can pack your classes in early and try to do a lot of them early on and have more time to do your research at the end, but I would discourage you from doing that necessarily. So the trick is you want to build a sustainable timeline that you can continue for the rest of your life. So you're building these habits that will go with you forever. Now, if you pack all of your courses in the first 2 years and get all of them done, then you're gonna have almost zero time to do your scholarly work during those first 2 years. I think a slightly more sustainable approach is to spread out the courses a little bit more. Some programs have more course requirements than others, but I don't think that you should only spend your first year just doing coursework. You need to get in the mindset of developing yourself in your scholarly discipline, and you need to do that beginning in the very first year. So whatever your schedule is, you need to make time for that, and that might mean stretching the courses out a little bit longer. I've seen that be very successful for students where they do maybe 3 classes in the first year, 3 classes in the second year, and that might leave them with 1 or 2 classes they need to do in the third year. So definitely allow the coursework to extend out if it facilitates you getting going in your research, because it'll take you a little time to get ramped up to do your research. There's a long period there. You don't want to begin doing your research in your third year because it's a little bit too late to build a whole body of scholarly work. So within this timeline, in addition to making sure you're pacing yourself appropriately, starting your scholarly work as early as possible in the process, I also want you to build in time for mistakes or errors. What I see a lot of the time is students will be at their 5th year and they need to get their final publication in or they don't graduate. And maybe they even have a job lined up afterwards, okay? And so they have to have a published paper in order to graduate is one of their requirements, but they left it to the very end to meet that requirement. And almost 100% of the time, there is a problem with that publication that they might have to submit a few times or redo it entirely, okay? But they didn't build in any timeline for errors or mistakes. Don't fall into that. What you need to do is to look at whatever the field that you want to go into, what the people who are getting hired now have on their CV, how many publications, how many awards, etc., and work backwards in your PhD. So say those top candidates have 10 papers, okay? Look at your PhD and say, that means I need to try to get 2 papers published a year. Great, okay, so that's your goal. Within that, if you're trying to get 10 papers published, you've got to assume that at least 4 of those are going to have some problems and take longer than expected. So you can't simply say, okay, I'll do 2 a year, bada bing, bada boom, I'm gonna get a great job. What you might need to do is kind of stagger things where you'll say, I'm going to start out with 2 my first year, and then my 2nd year, I'm going to try to push through 3, assuming that 1 of them will have a problem and it might take 1 or 2 to get that published. So it is so, so important for whatever your goals are to include times for errors, mistakes. Some things will take longer than other things, and you need to embed that into your timeline. Now, when you're thinking about these realistic expectations, one of the things I would encourage you to do is to take the formal milestones that are required in your department. This might be something like a first year project or a master's proposal or a dissertation proposal or maybe an examination of some sort, okay? Whatever those milestones are, and use those to achieve your ultimate goals for your career, okay? So that's to say one of the requirements is a literature review. Everyone does a literature review and they check it off their box and they move on, okay? Your goal should be, I want to do a literature review that I'm going to publish. The goal would be to use every single milestone to advance your goals. So you want to do the milestone and achieve your goals. So it's not like you're doing 2 things, it's serving the same purpose. And part of that is being honest with yourself. You do not have unlimited time. You're gonna have to work on milestones, okay? So you want to ensure that they serve multiple goals because you can't just invent more time for yourself. I think also within that, you need to identify your strengths and weaknesses and try to play to those. I don't think it's as easy as you might think to really excel in your weaknesses or grow as a person. Maybe you're gonna grow as a person, okay? But maybe a more realistic approach is to say, I'm gonna capitalize on my strengths and I'm gonna try to offset my weaknesses. So for example, with me, among my strengths are starting early. I can start things very, very early, in part because I have dyslexia, so it takes me longer to write papers than other people. But my weakness includes editing, doing fast revisions, doing things, high quality things at the end. So I play to my strengths. I start things way earlier than everyone else. People think I'm crazy for how early I start a project. I don't care. That's what I'm gonna do. I sometimes have to get faculty on board where, you know, we have a submission deadline in 9 months from now. And so they are not gonna start working on it till a few months before. And I'm starting on it now. And it's, you know, hard to get everyone on board, but I'm playing to my strengths. That's really how I need to do that work. Now, I think the major thing that you want to do is to create a timeline that's customized for you, your unique skill sets, the things that you need to work on, the specifics of your own degree and department, and your ultimate goals. You might have different goals than other people in your program, so you need to customize it for you. There are a lot of different tools out there for time management. I personally simply use Google Calendar, and I make timelines where I have the ending date of when I want to submit something, and then I work backwards. And I break down each sub goal into smaller individual bite-sized goals, usually by the week or 2 week period. So I know each week if I execute this type of thing, then ultimately I'll be ready for this timeline. And what I do is I never put the timeline as the actual timeline, I put it 2 weeks in advance. So whatever I'm submitting, I want it to be ready 2 weeks in advance. That gives me a buffer for errors and it gives me more time in the end to make it really polished. So the final project is truly, really strong. Finally, the last thing I'll say about time management is that I see consistently that PhD students put off the thing that they're scared of or afraid to do. So that might be something like a big challenge or something that just makes them uncomfortable that they don't want to do that they have to do. I would like you to have more self-control and whatever the thing that you're avoiding that is going on the bottom of your list, it's usually the hardest thing, block out time every week to do that. And maybe that's not something big like submitting a paper. Maybe you have social anxiety and it's responding to all of the emails that are piling up, okay? At some point, those will take over and take up too much of your time. So whatever your thing is that you are procrastinating, and I know you're doing it, I want you to set an hour on your schedule every week to do that thing. And you're not allowed to do anything else but that particular thing. That will get you in the habit of engaging with the hardest, most challenging tasks early and frequently and help you sustain a long career within academia. My closing thoughts for setting up a realistic PhD timeline is to be gentle to yourself. Recognize that there are going to be times where you feel exhilarated and you're really excited to do this work. Sometimes you're going to have pitfalls, setbacks, rejections that are going to be really hard. So the more you create a sustainable timeline that isn't filled with these moments of anxiety where it's lots of pressure, you're packing everything in, where you're kind of binging and purging like work strategy, but more of a consistent, manageable approach to your work, you will be a lot more successful and a lot happier. When I see students that are in more crisis, it's because they're packing in everything, you know, probably right before the timeline and they're stressed out and freaked out. And then right after the timeline, they have a huge crash and they can't do anything because they're burnt out for several weeks, maybe a month, okay? And they do that over and over and over again. And at some point you just can't do that. So you have no more steam for the rest of your PhD. Try to set up a schedule for yourself where you take that stress and just stretch out. I don't think there's a way to be in academia without stress, but you can either pack it in or you can have little bits of stress throughout the year. And I think that's a much more sustainable and healthy way to set up your PhD timeline. I hope this video was helpful. If you liked it, please consider hitting the like button and subscribe for more content on academic success. Take care.